In this video, I'm going to take a look at this 12-volt, 3000-watt pure sine wave inverter by TOPBULL. TOPBULL sent this out for me to review. I'm not very familiar with that brand, so I'm going to throw some tests at it, and we'll see if it stands up to what the manufacturer claims, and see if it's any good. Okay, let's take a real quick look at what came in the box. Got your basic owner's manual there, some good information in there. And then they sent 12 30-amp fuses that go inside. You have to take it apart to get inside. I'm not really sure why companies are including those. I guess it's a good thing. Then you have what looks like two sets of wires here. Two sets of negative, two sets of positive. But really, they're meant to be used all together at the same time. So these are 10-gauge wires. They say they're pure copper. So you're supposed to use all these together at the same time. One on the battery and one on the inverter. So we'll take a look at that and see if they get hot. Then you have a mechanical remote on-off switch. It's a mechanical switch, plugs in the side of the inverter there, and you can remotely turn it on and off if you need to. And of course we have the inverter. So here's the DC side, the battery side of the inverter, and it's got these little protective caps. Okay, here's the AC side. I plugged in a small 11 watt LED load just to show you a number other than zero for the watts being used. So every time you turn this thing on, it has a beep, and then the fans run for about 23, 4, 5, 6 seconds, somewhere in there. The decibels are about 69 when I'm not speaking. 69, 70. As I mentioned earlier, this is a 3,000-watt inverter. It has 6,000 watts peak. So over on the left we have USB-A, USB-C. We have two AC outlets. I have a load plugged in right now just so the watt meter doesn't have a big zero. Over on the right we have power on off switch, and then under that is the port for plugging in the remote control button. And then there's two vents here. Let's zoom in on the little LCD screen here. Okay, it's got a pure sine wave indicator there. It's 24 degrees Celsius. It's using 10 watts currently, 11 watts. The battery indicator on the bottom, I believe, is just a measurement of the voltage. The DC voltage from batteries is showing 12.9, which I'll test in a minute. And AC output is showing 113 volts, which I will also test. Now, there's one thing you may notice that's missing. A lot of these inverters, especially the larger ones like this, they have terminal blocks where you can hardwire into, like your whatever system you may have. I definitely would be something I would be looking for myself, but that's just me personally. That may not be something that you would be needing. Okay, I just want to quickly show my testing setup here. So I have two identical batteries. I wanted identical batteries hooked up here. It doesn't have to be, but I wanted identical batteries for the test. I have them hooked up in parallel using the supplied wires, my TOPBULL. We'll test those out. And of course, if you were running this in real life scenario, you would have a fuse here, but for this test, I'm not going to have a fuse. So hooking this up in the real world uses, you definitely want to have a fuse. So that's the setup. So one thing I wanted to show here real quick is that you remember that you use two sets of wires here. So when you do that, you have to orient the wires in this way to where they get a really good contact. And when you orient the wires that way, you can't get this protective cap on. So one wire would be better than multiple wires, or the wires designed in a way that they could stack together easily and just come out this one hole here. Okay, now I want to test this remote control button. So there's only one way to put this thing on. You can't do it incorrectly. The inverter is currently turned off, so let's see if this works. Yes, it does. Works good. Okay, so the DC voltage input on the inverter is showing 12.9, and I've measured it with a couple of different multimeters, and I'm getting 13.234 as the DC voltage on those. So the AC voltage is showing 112, 113, moving around there for on the inverter, and my multimeter is showing it's 114, so that's very close. Okay, I'm testing for pure sine wave. I have a space heater on. I'm currently drawing 750 watts. I have this all set up for testing pure sine wave, and that looks good. Okay, I'll do a quick USB test. Got a little fan, USB fan going here, and I've got my battery tester drawing from the USB port. And it looks like we are drawing 2.83 amps. And I don't know how much this little fan's drawing, but the watt display on the inverter does not show USB wattage, which is probably fine. So as much as I can draw out of this USB port is about this. It's showing 5 volts. Let me turn this up just slightly and you'll see it just cuts it off as soon as it gets about to 289. Oh, there it goes. So looks like about 289, 288 maybe as much as this USB port can draw. And I did test both USB-A and USB-C ports. So this is the continuous load test. Since this is a 3000 watt inverter, it should be able to run 3000 watts for, let's say, 10 minutes. So I'm going to crank up the oil heater in the floor. And that's going to bring these watts up pretty quick. And I'm gonna crank on the space heater. And the fans are going. So let me go ahead and hit start on the phone. As you can see, the watts are climbing. We are at 2,500. I think this is going to level out around 3,000. So we got 3,039, 3,034, 3,044, 49. Let's see how long we can run this here. Okay, we made it 10 minutes, no problem. It looks like the internal temperature of the inverter stabilized about 62. And the fans are running, and of course it's dropping, well, dropping temperature. Let me let those fans finish cooling this down and adjust the camera, and I'm gonna take some temperature of these wires. Okay, so the fan just cut off, and let's see if I can get some of these wire temperatures here. They've cooled down some. While it was running, I saw about 125, 130. So now they've come down quite a bit. And they're different temperatures per wire. Now this wire in between the batteries, I supplied myself. I think I got up to 91, 92, or there it is, 90, 96 actually. All right, so let me do quick show you this setup here. I'm gonna do a surge test here. I've got the oil heater in the floor, space heater all plugged in this little outlet, I mean power strip here. When I was trying to do the full load on a minute ago, it kept tripping out. So I'm just going to put the space heater on low. So it'll pull only about 2100 watts, something like that. And then for the surge, I'm going to hit this miter saw here. So I want you to take a close watch at what happens to the voltage when I do that here. All right, so let me go ahead and kick on the, space heater and four oil heater, and the fans on the inverter will kick on quick, and it should take us up to around, a little over 2000 watts. Oops. Okay, pay attention to the voltage over on the right under the fan spinning. I'm hitting the miter saw now. Okay, so the voltage dropped dramatically. We'll talk about what that means later. Okay, I now have the space heater and floor oil heater off, and now I'm gonna hit the miter saw just by itself. Let's pay attention to the voltage and wattage on that too. So I don't know if you could tell, but the miter saw sounded much more powerful then than it did when the others were running. So as part of the testing on my previous video where I did a review of the time USB battery, I run a refrigerated runtime test, which lasted 18 hours, and I did use this inverter to do that. And here's a little bit of the footage here that I did to run that. So I did use this in a real-world situation to run a refrigerator for 18 hours. Before I start talking about the test results, I wanted to mention that this inverter does have your standard protections, such as overload protection over voltage, undervoltage, high temperature, and short circuit. But it also has a couple additional protections not typically found. Those are leakage and reverse polarity protection. Okay, so the test results were interesting. The general testing went well. The USB outlets, the AC outlets, the remote control button, all work expected. It charged my phone. The AC output had a pure sine wave. If I didn't mention it already, the AC output is 110 volts, not 120. These fans kicked on. They were a little on the loud side, so it may not be the best choice if your inverter is going to be in living space with you. The 10-minute continuous load test went very well. It held near 3,000 watts for 10 minutes, so no issues. The fans kicked on, kept the heat from building up. They only turned on when they needed to, so that load test went well. You saw it actually run my refrigerator for over 18 hours when I was testing how long a battery would last running my refrigerator. But as you saw with the surge test, the voltage drop, adding a large inductive load on top of an existing load, was significant. The AC output voltage dropped all the way to 85 volts, while the watts remain basically unchanged. That's not good for computers and sensitive electronics. That miter saw surged to about 2400 watts when I had nothing else on the inverter, and it handled that very well by itself. But when we had a load over 2000 watts and I turned on that miter saw, instead of ramping up the watts over 4000 like it should have and maintaining voltage, it dropped the voltage. Again, that might be fine for heaters and lights and things like that, but low voltages can actually damage some electronics. Just to satisfy my curiosity, I actually pulled out two other 12-volt inverters from different companies, and I performed the same surge test to see how the voltage would hold up under those on those. The only difference were that these inverters were 2,000-watt inverters, but neither one of those inverters would power the miter saw at all, even by itself. So those 2,000-watt inverters had a 4,000-watt surge capacity, and so you would have thought they would have started the miter saw, but they would not. So as you saw when I ran the miter saw on this TOPBULL all by itself, it handled that just fine. The inverter can deal with these large inductive loads. So I have to give this inverter a big ding for dropping the voltage and not peaking up towards 6,000 like it should have in my surge test. Another issue I discovered was that the battery voltage on the LCD screen was quite a bit off from the actual battery voltage. It was reading just too low, so I have to give it another ding for that. Now let's talk about the cables they included with this inverter. Typically, those cables are just junk, and you toss them sometimes. But the included wires here are a little better than normal, as long as you use both sets, as they stated. They did say that they were solid copper. Now, I saw on their website that you're supposed to use both these sets on one, like the positive terminal, but I didn't see that in the owner's manual. They did heat up during the load test, but they were not extremely hot. They have a rating on the wire of 200 degrees Celsius, and I think in the test I saw as high as 54 degrees Celsius or 130 degrees Fahrenheit. So we're dealing with amps here well over 200, so these wires really need to be larger. So I would recommend getting larger wires if you're running this inverter unattended, especially in a house. And of course you want to install a properly sized fuse. I didn't in my testing, but as I mentioned, you want to have a fuse. I would also prefer just one large wire like this one over two sets of wires like these, because it just makes it difficult to get a really good connection on the battery side over here when you're having to stack wires like that. So who is this inverter for? Well, if you want to run some power tools and heaters and lights, etc., you know, on a job site, for example, this inverter would be great for that. If you just wanted to run some appliances like your coffee maker, toaster oven, space heaters, lights, maybe even refrigerator, as I showed in my test, I think it would work for that also. But where I would not recommend this inverter is when you need a combination of larger loads along with sensitive electronics at the same time. The voltage drop in this situation is just too much and could lead to damaging those electronics. Given that you understand those limitations, this seems to be a decent budget-priced inverter. You're most likely not going to find a perfect budget inverter at this price level. So what is the price? So the price on this inverter is just under $220 on Amazon. It comes with a one-year materials workmanship warranty. Also, I didn't have a chance to find anything out about customer service. I couldn't find anything. So if you have any experience with our customer service, please leave a link below so we'll all learn from that. Well, I guess this wraps up the review. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching.